Penguin Audio presents Duke, A Life of Duke Ellington by Terry Teachout. Read by Peter Francis James. To Mrs. T, who was never in doubt. There is one very good thing to be said of posterity, and this is that it turns a blind eye on the defects of greatness. W. Somerset Maugham. We wear the mask that grins and lies. Paul Laurence Dunbar. Prologue. I want to tell America. He was the most chronic of procrastinators, a man who never did today what he could put off until next month or next year. He left letters unanswered, contracts unsigned, watches unworn, and longtime companions unwed. And the only thing harder than getting him out of bed in the afternoon was getting him to finish writing a new piece of music in time for the premiere. I don't need time, he'd like to say. What I need is a deadline. Nothing but an immovable deadline could spur Duke Ellington to decisive action. Though once he set to work in earnest, it was with a speed and self-assurance that amazed all who beheld it. At the end of his life, he left behind some 1,700-odd compositions, a number that is hard to square with the memories of his collaborators, who rarely failed at one time or another to be frustrated by his dilatory ways. That was fine with him. He knew what he needed in order to create, and as far as he was concerned, nothing and no one else mattered. As long as something is unfinished, he told Louis Armstrong, there's always that little feeling of insecurity. And a feeling of insecurity is absolutely necessary unless you're so rich that it doesn't matter. Few of his pronouncements can be taken at face value. He was never in the habit of telling anyone, even those who supposed themselves to be his friends, what he really thought. But this one has the ring of truth. He wants life and music to be in a state of becoming, said the trumpeter Clark Terry, one of the many stars of the band that Ellington led from 1924 until his death a half century later. He doesn't even like to write definitive endings to a piece. Whether it was true or merely one of his rationalizations for doing whatever he wanted to do, whenever he wanted to do it, Ellington lived by those words. Time and again, he found himself bumping up against deadlines because of his reluctance to finish what he had started. More often than not, his talent got him out of the holes he dug for himself, and when it didn't, he counted on his charm to see him through. Duke drew people to him like flies to sugar, said Sonny Greer, one of his oldest friends, and his drummer for 3 decades. He was well aware of how charismatic he was, and used his powers without scruple whenever he thought it necessary. Once in a while, though, he cut it too close for comfort, and in the frantic days and nights leading up to his Carnegie Hall debut on January 23, 1943, some of his colleagues began to wonder whether Harlem's aristocrat of jazz, as his publicists dubbed him, had finally outsmarted himself. As early as 1930, Ellington was telling reporters of his plans to compose a piece of program music about the black experience. My African suite, he called it. It will be in 5 parts, starting in Africa and ending with the history of the American Negro. Sometimes he described it as a multi-movement instrumental work, sometimes as an opera. But either way, he made it sound as if the ink were wet on the page, and his serpentine way with words never failed to hypnotize even the most suspicious of interviewers into assuming that the curtain was about to go up. In 1933, Hannon Swaffer, an English columnist, published an interview in which Ellington spoke of the unwritten work so evocatively that you could all but hear it playing in the background. I'm expressing in sound the old days in the jungle, the cruel journey across the sea, and the despair of the landing, and then the days of slavery. I traced the growth of a new spiritual quality, and then the days in Harlem and the cities of the United States. then I try to go forward 1,000 years. I seek to express the future when, emancipated and transformed, the Negro takes his place, a free being, among the peoples of the world. Swaffer was no friend of jazz or of blacks. He had once compared Louis Armstrong to a gorilla, but he bought Ellington's story hook, line, and sinker. All this was said with a quietness of dignity, he assured his readers. I heard almost a whisper of prophecy. Many more journalists would prove as willing to take Ellington at his oft-repeated word. That same year, Fortune told its readers that he was writing a suite in 5 parts. With this suite in his repertoire, Ellington may someday make his Carnegie Hall debut. In 1938, Downbeat reported that he had finished work on a full-length opera about the history of the American Negro. The truth was less impressive. Not only had he written none of his African suite, but he completed only 3 extended works of any kind prior to 1943, and the longest of them, Reminiscing in Tempo, ran for just 12 minutes, the length of the first movement of a symphony. Constant Lambert, the most perceptive of all the classically trained music critics to write about Ellington in the 30s, praised him as the first jazz composer of distinction, and compared him to Ravel and Stravinsky. But he also acknowledged that Ellington was a petit maître, whose best works were written in what may be called 10-inch record form. Into this 3.5 minutes he compresses the utmost, but beyond its limits, he is inclined to fumble. Even if his African suite was anything more than a fantasy, how could a petit maître manage to pull such a work out of his hat? Instead, he kept on carving 1 3.5-minute cameo after another, and the only sign that he wanted to do something grander was his insistence on telling credulous reporters that he had either done so or was about to. That was Ellington's way. He talked not to explain himself, but to conceal himself. Even Ruth, his adoring younger sister, said that he definitely wasn't direct. He wasn't direct with anybody about anything. Yet he talked so fluently and impressively that nearly everyone believed him, save for those who had reason to know better. In one of his most frequently cited verbal arabesques, he claimed that Harlem Airshaft, which he recorded in 1940, was a musical depiction of the sounds of black apartment life. You hear fights, you smell dinner, you hear people making love, you hear intimate gossip floating down, you hear the radio. An air shaft is one great big loudspeaker. It's a splendidly quotable tale, so much so that one hates to point out that the composition known as Harlem Airshaft started life as Once Over Lightly, a title that has nothing to do with life in a Harlem apartment house. Ellington talked with similarly seductive fluency when luring women into bed, drawing on an endless supply of the come-on lines that a friend of his dubbed crotch warmers, most of which appear on paper to be eye-rollingly florid. I knew you were here because the whole studio was suddenly aglow with a turquoise radiance, but which carried the force of iron conviction when spoken with his fine-grained bass baritone voice. Ellington kept on talking about his soon-to-be-completed tone poem opera symphony suite for as long as he could get away with it. Then in December of 1942, he stopped talking and started writing, announcing that the centerpiece of his Carnegie Hall program would be the premiere of what he now called Black, Brown, and Beige, a tone parallel to the history of the American Negro. The concert, which took place 6 weeks later, was a celebration of his 20th anniversary as a bandleader, and there were those, Ellington among them, who thought it far past time for him to appear at the best-known concert hall in America. Benny Goodman, after all, had played Carnegie Hall in 1938, and though 3 of Ellington's top sidemen, Harry Carney, Johnny Hodges, and Cootie Williams, were featured at that concert, the humiliating fact was that the King of Swing had beaten Harlem's aristocrat of jazz to the punch. Ellington, who was invited to sit in on piano with his own men and Goodman's rhythm section, declined with thanks, but came to the concert. "He was furious," said a friend who saw him there. "He was just livid." The event brought Goodman reams of free publicity, not to mention vast amounts of highbrow reclame, a commodity that Ellington coveted fiercely. Irving Mills, the manager who was chiefly responsible for making him a celebrity, had gone to enormous trouble to promote him not merely as the leader of a black dance band, but as a musical giant. The publicity manuals that Mills Artists Incorporated sent out to the managers of the theaters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.